you're watching Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods.
Dust him off.
Get him out of the closet.
Put on your dancing shoes.
You're going to the dance.
A trip to the NCAA tournament is automatic.
Welcome to the Phillips 66 Big 12 Championship, all part of Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. The number one seed in the tournament, the Kansas Jayhawks, who have dominated this competition, having won 8 of the previous 16 Big 12 Championship. And they are matched against the upstart Texas Tech Red Raiders, who last night upset West Virginia at the buzzer. Watch Dayon Kravitz not blocked out the putback basket that advanced the Red Raiders to today's quarterfinal round. As you take a look at the brackets, the winner of today's game will move along to meet Iowa State tomorrow evening. And then tonight, Kansas State, Texas, Oklahoma State, Baylor. So it has been a wonderful day of quarterfinal action so far, and more to come as the Cyclones rallied in that first game. Welcome back, everybody. With Fran Fischilla, I'm Brett Musburger. You know, Fran, Kansas Jayhawks, everybody understands this. They're a team that could go all the way to Atlanta, cut down the nets. But they're coming off a very bad showing in their final regular season game that you did down at Baylor.
Second worst loss in Bill Self's tenure at Kansas, which means you can bet the practices were lively this week. They want some momentum coming out of this tournament, because remember, Brent, there's a high likelihood they'll be right back here next week playing in the NCAA tournament.
Now, how about our matchup of guards, Josh Gray and Elijah Johnson?
I like Josh Gray. Reminds me of a young Rodney Strickland, his ability to get into the lane and make plays. Still learning as a point guard. Of course, we saw that great performance by Elijah Johnson at Iowa State. He's played very good basketball down the stretch. They need him to be at his best if Kansas is going to make a long, lengthy run in the NCAA tournament.
So for the Red Raiders, their starting lineup looks like this. It is a very young team with only one senior, and he will wear number 55 again. That is Ty Nurse, his number 4 jersey with his name on the back, left back in Lubbock. And a very veteran team representing the Jayhawks. Bill Self starts 4 seniors and a redshirt freshman by the name of Ben McLemore, and he may be one of those one-and-done guys. We'll see about that. Meanwhile, Chris Walker, first-year coach at Texas Tech. Holly Rowe, quite a story.
Well, it's been an up-and-down season for Texas Tech when their head coach, Billy Gillespie, resigned the end of September, just 8 days before fall practice was to start. Chris Walker was elevated to the interim head coach. He inherited a program that was fractured. These kids were hurting after allegations of mistreatment by their former coach. So he has brought them together. In the locker room last night, it was special. The kids had come together. They've weathered the storm. And I asked Chris Walker, do you think this will help you keep your job? He said, this is absolutely not about me. This is about the kids.
Coach Walker played Villanova, participated in a couple of NCAA tournaments. And Coach Fran, what kind of a chance do you give the Red Raiders for their second upset against Bill Self's Jayhawks?
Well, it's a long shot, no question. They're coming off a thrashing in Lawrence on senior day just last week. But remember, a couple weeks before that, they actually had Kansas only lead them by 2 in Lubbock. So they need to play nearly perfectly.
And we'll see how the Jayhawks respond here in the early going. Johnson, the point guard, sends it to Rutherford. They feed Withy and down low, loose ball. Red Raiders go to the floor. Got the first turnover. Rutherford goes back, tries to get it. Ball out of bounds. Our officiating crew, Mark Whitehead, Paul Jansen, Rod Dixon. And they say that the Jayhawks will have possession.
Little surprise that Rutherford threw that ball down by Withy's knees. When you're 7 feet, they're so good at throwing that ball up over the top. It's hard for that big fella to go get it. Oh, you like those unis, Brent? Those shorts?
No. I'll reserve judgment.
Not traditional, but this time of year, everybody's trying to sell sneakers.
Feet down low again, this time with the goes back in, and there's a pushing foul. It's going to go over. We traveled.
I think the official, Mark Whitehead, said that Withy had dribbled the ball. It looked like he bobbled it and then dribbled it again. You can actually bobble the ball, but he said that he dribbled it first.
That'd be a double dribble, is that right?
That's what we used to call it in the schoolyard in Brooklyn. I don't know about up in Montana.
We used to allow double dribbles. Get it back into the low post, and he traveled. So we've had double dribble, traveling. Got a scramble for a loose ball on the floor.
I think if you're Kansas, normally Bill Self will tell you that this is their third season. Non-conference first, conference regular season. This is the third season right now. Not as much emphasis on this normally. There's a lob.
McLemore finishes it. You could see that coming right from it.
Absolutely. Bill Self always got some sneaky stuff in his back pocket.
Here's Gray, who Fran talked about at the top of the broadcast, played very, very well last night in that upset of the Mountaineers. Williams handling the ball against this Jayhawk defense. Now there's inside of 10 on the shot. Gray with the pull-up three and winds up in Young's hands, and here come the Jayhawks.
Last two times they played, they backed off Young.
Rutherford kicked to the corner. Johnson's three ball back in his hands after the miss. McLemore nails a three. A two on the slam, then a smooth three. And the Red Raiders burn an early timeout. Talk about Ben McLemore and the way he started here today, Fran.
Well, I think it's important. Bill Self has loved the way he's played all year. This comes right out of the gate early in the game. A set play, back screen lob, trying to get his freshman going. And part of the issue, Brent, for McLemore this year is wanting them to be more aggressive early on. You like this a lot.
So Coach Walker burns an early timeout, trying to settle his troops down here against a heavily favored Jayhawks. About a three touchdown favorite in this one, folks.
Problem is, they don't have Cliff Kingsbury throwing the ball.
Don't have Wes Welker.
That's right.
The former Red Raider who was sent and signed a contract with Denver. Tom Brady will miss him. Head pass by Elijah now. Here's Young. He'll be on the free throw line. He'll shoot a pair.
Kevin Young's had two good games against Texas Tech, 14 in each. And of course, we've enjoyed watching him all year, be the garbage man for this starting lineup. Transfer from Loyola Marymount.
This will take a very inspired effort by the Red Raiders. Just as you look, the eyeball test tells you that the Jayhawks.
You've done this a while.
And now Crockett scored a team-high 18 last night coming off the bench against the Mountaineers. So he checks in as Jay Crockett.
He's one of the best six men, not only in the Big 12, but in the country. And Chris Walker wanting to get his firepower on the floor early.
Robinson is also on the floor for Texas Tech. Has been suffocating Kansas defense here. Robinson, no foul. Young taps it ahead. Here comes McLemore for his third field goal. I'd say they got him off in this game.
I'd say that he's been aggressive, and that was a save that one for a poster. Right now they can't get that ball inside, and that's where their scoring should come from.
triple team into Withy's hands. On a McLemore, and the pass was a little bit too far in front of him and out of bounds for the turnover.
You know, Ben McLemore, we're going to enjoy watching him next year. I think he could be the number one pick in the draft. I've said that back in December. Doc Sadler calls him Brent the Natural because he's so gifted, makes it look so easy.
Yeah, that's a good description.
Yeah.
He is certainly not selfish in our observation about the young man. I have to say that.
He had that 30-plus point game against Iowa State early in the year. I think he took 11 shots.
Feed inside, and a good strong finish by Jordan Tolbert, and the Red Raiders are on the board.
Tolbert and Crockett are their two go-to scorers. Unfortunately, they both play inside, so they got to deal with Withy all night.
And Young again is fouled on the play. So we'll take a break here at the 15:44 mark. Jayhawks jump out ahead in their quarterfinal match.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Phillips 66, experts in gas since 1927, and in part by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's, and Infinity, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance.
8-2, Kansas leads Texas Tech. Well, Chris Walker, if there is such a thing as a coaching bubble, he very much is on it. This is a job he would like to retain next year, but the school has not made a decision. Certainly last night had to help him. And after the upset of West Virginia, he wrote the key word on the board, attitude. And they had it last night in that win.
Nothing good can happen unless you have a win. That's what it's all about, guys. You gotta be good. What did I say on the bench at Kansas the other day? I said, don't worry, we'll be back. We ain't running from that. We're not running from that, fellas. That's what you should want as a competitor, because that's what I want. Everybody got that?
Young man played for Raleigh Massimino at Villanova, didn't he, Fran?
Sure did. Played in two NCAA tournaments. Interesting sidelight stat about Chris Walker. Second most three-point shot attempts in the history of the NCAA tournament. 6 of 20. Now, you wouldn't go inside against LSU back then because they had a guy named Shaq O'Neal and another guy named Stanley Roberts. So, but he was a very good point guard at Villanova. Played on some good teams.
Foot.
You know, I've watched Texas Tech all year, and they have played hard. They're well organized, prepared. They just don't have the material necessary to have a lot of success just yet, but there's no question they have not played hard.
Dusty Hannon checks in off the Red Raider bench. He wears number 2. He'll be out there now.
He can shoot it.
Looking for daylight, and they knew it, and Rutherford jumped on him, forced the turnover.
I think if you're Bill Self right now, you just want execution. You want to use this game to get better and better.
Elijah Johnson coming down the baseline.
Kansas, Brent, you're going to play 20 feet and in and make him shoot over the top.
Into Withy's hands.
See, they're not going to guard Kevin Young. They're going to double team Withy with Young's man.
McLemore knocks down another three ball. His second three ball of this game. He's hit all three of his field goal attempts. I should say four. He's off to a 10-point start.
If Kansas is going to go far in the NCAA tournament, Elijah Johnson's critical, but Ben McLemore, his ability to get easy baskets just as much.
Missing at the perimeter, McLemore rebounded. On the deck. And he is fouled, so he'll come to the free throw line. One of the things about McLemore, Fran, as you know, in the NCAA tournament, there comes a time
when a big player has to step out, take charge of a game to get you through, yep. You know, survive and move on. McLemore strikes me as the kind of a youngster in the NCAA tournament who can do just that. You can ride his back in an individual game.
No, I couldn't agree more. You know, you've seen so many tournament games that are 60-58 with 5 minutes to go, and then somebody makes three threes and the game's over. And he's capable of doing that.
I also think it's a very well-equipped Kansas game. I question their depth if they get into foul trouble. The freshman from Wichita has come along, and he's in the lineup right now, and that's Perry Ellis. He's probably the best substitute in terms of scoring. I think you agree that he's been improving his game.
Oh, I really like his effort, energy, no question about it. Well, how about this, Brent? How about all the TV timeouts in the NCAA tournament? The chance to rest a team like Kansas that doesn't have a lot of depth, right?
Good point.
But you do need that 6th, 7th guy to get you through foul trouble. Perry Ellis can do that.
Tharp is out on Gray. Tharp has checked in for Kansas. Gray is back. He's handling the ball right now. Coach Walker. The iron into with his hands again. I think all the Iowa State fans who stayed here are just dreaming about round three. They're on the turnover. Gray's going to take it down on Ellis into the left hand and didn't finish it.
But Ellis got him with a little push in the back.
Yeah, Williams knocks one down from outside, and it's 15-5.
Young man from Brooklyn, New York, who found his way to the South Plains via Lakeland College in Illinois.
Shoots up an air ball, and here come the Red Raiders again, looking to put together field goal. Gray gets inside, out of bounds. It'll be Red Raider basketball.
And Josh Gray's a guy, Brent, that signed at Mississippi State last year, was going to play for Rick Stansbury when the coaching change was made. He jumped on board the Lubbock Express, and I like his potential. And he's got a coach who's been a point guard, who's tried to tame him a little bit and teach him how to run a team.
The floor adjustment now with Tharp and Elijah Johnson both playing. Williams penetrates, tried to get to the rim. That is tough to do against Jeff Withey. Blocking foul.
Ty Nurse finishing up his career. He played on the Canadian national team with guys like Corey Joseph, Tristan Thompson, Kelly Olynyk.
Played so well last night.
Yeah.
While wearing 55. Told him just leave that number full of my name on it, just back home.
Just go down to Dick's Sporting Goods and stick 5 letters on the back, don't you think?
Coach Knight would applaud, no name on it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And yes, the mascot doesn't have a name, so he becomes only the 2nd. Pistols up, big fella. Tharp, 3-ball rims out. Gray almost lost it, dribbles away.
And that's part of Gray's maturation process. Sometimes he gives that ball a headache, dribbles it a little too much.
On the run, last night's hero, Dayon Kravitch.
I know some good trivia about him later. You're going to be very interested to know some stuff about him.
Good. Knocked away by Kravitch. Here he comes in a foot race. Ellis rolls back. Oh! And one. Kravitch put together nice field goals here for the Red Raiders.
That's a young man that transferred from York University in Toronto. He's a Canadian player. One of the best there, decided to come down to the South. Got through customs okay, and now he's doing a nice job in Lubbock.
Quite a lineup on ESPN Saturday. Super Saturday has 5 games, 3 conference championship games. We'll have both ACC semifinals, and then we'll come right back here to Kansas City for the Phillips 66 Big 12 championship, and that'll be followed by the Big East championship from Madison Square Garden and the Pac-12
Championship from the MGM Arena out in Las Vegas. It's all part of Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. All right, my friend, tell me something I don't know.
This young man, Dejan Kravic, his family emigrated from Bosnia-Herzegovina during all the chaos of the 90s, but they're from the Dinaric Mountain region, the Southern Alps. The world's tallest people come from that part of the world, come from that his home part of Bosnia-Herzegovina. The average male, about 6 foot one.
You know, I didn't know that.
How about that? See?
That's pretty impressive.
By the way, he's 6'11". But family teachers came to Toronto. He's actually a very good player in the Canadian College Leagues. He just wanted a change of pace and pretty good start.
And he could always go back to Europe and play, too.
I think he could. Absolutely.
It's amazing how many of the youngsters that we have in college are now playing over there.
Absolutely. And how many kids from Europe are now playing in college basketball.
Absolutely. Yeah, it kind of became, you know, the world game. They talked a lot about the growth of what we call soccer in the United States, but I think instead it's almost been basketball that we've exported that became more of a world game.
Yep.
See what finally happens in China now in the next couple of decades.
Good job. Good scouting report defense by Texas Tech so far.
You know, it's a five-point game.
Yeah.
There's a traveling. And the kids are playing hard. I'm impressed by that.
Now, they have a good scheme. You can tell. They're not playing Kevin Young.
That's a lot of turnovers for the Jayhawks in this game. They have to.
You know that? Well, they struggled in Lubbock with this team.
Travis tried to get it inside. It was read perfectly by Young. Forced the turnover. Coach Walker not happy about that. That's a 3-0. It was not. It was a pass instead, and they make the two work on the inside of that for a moment. Young was going to come up with the board.
Well, because Kevin Young's not being guarded at the high post, it's almost like a quarterback with no pressure on him, no blitz. Good look over the top.
Maybe they can borrow one of Fred Hoiberg's three-point shooters here. Get themselves back in this. What a good second half that was in our
tremendous first
game.
Yep. He said it. He said at the half he was happy with the last 5 minutes of the first half, and he certainly was prophetic.
Over the top. Tolbert has it stripped and taken away. Traylor was there. Jamari Traylor, another of the youngsters off Self's bench. And coming through is Tharp, and the foul is going to be on Gray. Gray picks up the person.
Look at this, Brent. They had a mismatch inside. Watch Tharp on Tolbert. Tolbert gets away, but that ball was in the air too long, and then Traylor comes over and helps. I thought we had some great matchups in that first game. You mentioned Edgen and Osby, Niang. Certainly Clyburn took over down the stretch.
Great drive by Tharp. Finished with the left hand.
Well, we always talked about how much Relaford and Withy have improved. This guy's come a long way since last year.
And a foul is going to be called. I believe Elijah Johnson was in underneath. Committed the personal. Jayhawks up by 9.
That's Tharp now. They're not letting him get to the screen, so they give him an alley. Sometimes when you keep a player from using the screen, you allow him a straight line drive to the basket. He averaged 0.9 points a game last year, and he's certainly a much improved player than the guy that we saw a year ago.
Over the top again by Kravic to Tolbert. Nice little shot. A 7-point Jayhawk advantage.
Kravic is a guy that had 20 in a game against Oklahoma.
There's Kravic coming up with a turnover against Young on him.
That's just not a good angle to throw a bounce pass in.
Gotcher on the floor for the Red Raiders. Spins Kravic. Nice looking things.
Yep.
That's 9 points for him here in the first half. 19-14. Texas Tech trying to hang tough here.
ESPNU provides comprehensive coverage of the entire postseason with Tournament Countdown. Must watch before you fill out your bracket. ESPNU's Tournament Countdown starts Sunday night, 9 p.m. with the NIT Selection Show, followed by the experts who discuss every first and second round NCAA tournament matchup. ESPNU Tournament Countdown, Sunday through Friday.
I'll be on that show. Does that make me an expert? it's built that way, right?
Are you a good bracketologist?
No. I know so much that my brackets blow up in the first two rounds.
I mean, you didn't have Missouri losing in that first round?
I didn't. No, but I have members of my family who pick by colors, which team is closer to New York.
My wife used the Wall Street Journal bracket. I was very happy to beat it. McElmore off the iron. I'll tell you what, Gravich has scored the last nine Texas Tech points. He's keeping them in this game, fine. Down by five.
Yes, he has. And what I also like about Tech, you can see they have a game plan defensively.
McElmore almost stole it.
I mean, can you think of Withy catching the ball cleanly so far in this game? And we're 9 minutes, 11 minutes in.
Yeah, they've done a very good job of him. And they're a little bit undersized when you look at them, too.
When you're in a game like this, you're playing the percentages, and you're just hoping that Kansas will miss enough shots.
The Jayhawks got off to that positive start. Maybe they thought this was going to be easy. I'll tell you, got to be impressed with Kravitz's hustle.
Absolutely. Got to the floor, knew where to throw it. Got to be a thrill for Robinson. He's in his hometown playing in a Big 12 tournament.
Indeed. Three-second violation.
Now, scoring is easier said than done.
You know, if Bill Self had complained about that 3 seconds couple of journeys ago, and it paid off for him.
Yeah. Well, let's just watch Kansas and see where Withy lines up, and now they're in a little zone now, so they switch to the zone. Good change up.
Took it high, gave it back to McElmore. Johnson comes in now, Belford attacks. Good ball movement against that defense.
Yep. Recognize it right away. Again, when you're the underdog, you try to change up, change defenses, keep the team that's favored to win off balance.
I think Phillip can handle the ball, too.
Yeah, that's right. I think he's going to get renewed interest from Kevin Young now, Kravitz.
Shot clock expired. Turnover. Jayhawk basketball when you come back. So Jayhawks took advantage early, but
McElmore was on fire early, Brent. You gotta love the way he plays, and Texas Tech, they're hanging around.
Brent Whiteside of the studio over on ESPNU. ACC first round, Virginia Tech, NC State. Richard Howell, 7 of 9 from the field. He has 14, pacing the Wolfpack, currently up 8. Winner gets Virginia tomorrow. Halftime at the Garden. C.J. Fair hit a 3 that touched every part of the rim at the buzzer. Hey, you want another Georgetown-Syracuse matchup? We are halfway to that. Brent, Fran.
All right, Fran, thank you. Here are the Jayhawks up 7. And Holly Rowe, why did Coach Self use a timeout there?
Well, he was very calm in the huddle. He just drew up two different plays, one for if Texas Tech is in zone and one for if they're in man. But he said, all right, guys, we had our little lull there. It's time to play now. He pointed out that they're in the bonus. He wants them to be aggressive, drive, and get to the line.
Rowe trying to do just that was cut off. Now they get it into Withy, and he'll give it back to Young on the drive. That's aggressive.
And then what you love about that is that they're not going to play Kevin Young at the foul line with his man. All he's got to do is cut to the rim, and they weren't able to react quick enough to Red Raiders.
Herself has his starting five on the floor. Catch and shoot. Hannons knocks it down. It's a three ball.
Yeah, this guy comes to Texas Tech with that reputation out of Arkansas, all-state player last year, outstanding scorer.
Wow, got a steal now. coming in on Rutherford, driving in, and he's going to be on the free throw line. Knocks down a three, steals the ball, fouled by Rutherford, coming to the line. You were right about this.
Yep.
What happened to the Razorbacks? How'd they miss out on this one?
It may not have fit in that 40 minutes of hell, but Billy Gillespie, you know, signed him and done a nice job. He's one of those guys I would redshirt if I could, if I had the luxury here at Texas Tech, because he's going to be a good player. Just has to get stronger.
If you don't have the coaching job, you ain't redshirting anybody.
Yeah, that's right.
you're going all out for W.
That's a good point. That's a great point. No, you're right. Chris Walker looking to get every win and pad that resume as best he can. And this guy had 40 plus in the state championship game last year at Arkansas.
That's a good looking shot.
Yep. Well, that's why he's not at Ouachita Baptist now, or John Brown University in Arkansas. He's here in the Big 12.
Right? Exactly. Johnson got by him, floated it. Nice play.
Very nicely done. Little one-legged runner. Tell you what. Kevin Young's getting away with a little contact right there.
Six minutes here in the first half. Rutherford moves in, can't steal. Hammett goes to the deck, still loose. We got bodies all over the place. We're going to go over here. Timeout has been called. Well, the Big 12 awards were handed out prior to the start of this tournament. First team and rookie team, Ben McLemore, Jeff Withy, defensive player of the year. He also made the first team. Travis Rutherford made the second team. He was all defensive player.
Yep. Withy and Rutherford, two guys that are fifth-year seniors who really climbed up that depth chart for Bill Self and turned himself into terrific Big 12 players. Of course, Ben McLemore, we've seen it all year, Brett. Been brilliant. Likely one and done here, off to the NBA draft in June. And someone's going to get a guy that has a chance to be an absolute NBA star someday.
You know, when you think about it, the Jayhawks face a major rebuilding job next year.
Well, they do. They've got a really good recruiting class coming in. They've got some young guys now in a rotation, Ellis Tharp. Redshirting Landon Lucas over there on the bench.
Big fella stuck right with it. Deion Krebich. And he has 11 points here in the first half against this Jayhawk team.
Yeah, they're not letting McLemore get to the middle of the floor off the dribble.
The Raiders within four. Stop here would be important. McLemore did lose it. Held ball, and it's going to go over. Texas Tech basketball. How about this, ladies and gentlemen?
This is what you call a good audition if you're Chris Walker right now.
No question. Splendid job last night.
Team is prepared. They're playing hard. They're doing some things defensively, not getting burst on any drives.
As Williams penetrating. That feeds it in low to Tolbert. Boy, three defenders hit over there. Williams loose in the lane. He did everything but make the shot. Back down now to Rutherford. McLemore, the J, smooth.
Last time I saw a jump shot that smooth, his name was Ray Allen.
Yeah, he is smooth as silk, isn't he?
Oh, wow, that's his third time out.
Yeah, Walker.
He thinks he's in the NBA. I know one guy that's going to be in the NBA.
For sure. We just watched it.
And here he is right here, because this guy got off to a sizzling start. Bill Self ran the first offensive set of the game for him, and then he pretty much, Brent, you got to love the fact that he's been aggressive and certainly providing some highlights for his team.
14 points. Franny's 5 of 6 from the field. Get rid of a little excess tape.
Mm-hmm.
check in with Holly on that tape.
Well, it doesn't appear to be serious, but Ben McLemore did get his right wrist taped. He was just complaining of a little soreness to their athletic trainer, Bill Cowgill. They've taped it up. But you saw that silky smooth shot. I really don't think it's bothering him.
We need to tape everybody.
6-point lead. 4.5 minutes to go in the first half. Shot clock winds down toward 10. Now 5. In low. And Withy commits the foul, and Tolbert will move to the free throw line and shoot a pair.
Good possession. Jordan Tolbert, the sophomore from Fort Worth, not afraid of taking that ball right up through Jeff Withy's nose. They ran the clock. They got exactly what they looked for out of that, what we call, horn set. That was the perfect example, Brent. You've heard me say, when you got a shot blocker, you got to go right through his face. That's exactly what he did.
Red Raiders are hanging in. Down by a couple of field goals here at the 4-minute mark of the first half. Got a little zone at him. Withy steps into the middle. Ravage doing a good job on Withy down low. Johnson goes now to McLemore. McLemore off the dribble, kicks Johnson, on gun the three. Off the side, long rebound. Hannes went to the floor, couldn't come up with it. 4 on the shot, McLemore off iron, and it's Texas Tech basketball with a chance to move within 2 or 1.
Good,
what a gutting performance.
Absolutely.
This is.
Yep. And then, you know what? The zone, think about it. They don't have a 98 mile an hour fastball with their man to man. So the zone is the curveball. Mix it up.
I'm impressed with the hustle I'm looking at. Tolbert.
Oh, boy.
Rattles one in. Hello. Look what we've got. Kansas led this game, folks, 15-2, if you're just joining us. Ellis back to Johnson. They move it around the horn now. Ellis comes inside left-handed. Freshman finishing.
Yeah, he's a very unassuming player. He reminds me a little bit of Shane Battier, but only in demeanor.
It's a hell ball. Johnson coming in behind. He's going to go over on the possession.
Well, you like this, Brent. Take a look at Jordan Tolbert. When you got a shot blocker, you neutralize his space by going right up through him. Look, Withy can't get near that shot. That's pretty good basketball.
Bram Whiteside in the studio coming up on the Buffalo Wild Wings halftime report. One last dance as Big East partners before they head to the ACC together. Orange hoping to hold on to a 13-point halftime lead over Pitt. We'll have highlights there. Plus, Miles Simon joins me to break down the best finish of the day so far. A buzzer beater in the Illinois-Minnesota game. Brent, Fram, see you in a few.
All right, Bram, we look forward to that. 29-25, Kansas with the lead. And for Holly, when Coach Walker had the team together, what was his key word prior to this game?
Amnesia. The last time they met the Kansas Jayhawks, they lost by 37 points just 2 games ago. It was senior night at Fog Allen. He said, we got buried. We have to forget that. We have to come out and feel like we can compete, and so far they are.
Indeed. So it was attitude after the game last night, amnesia before this one, and with it, with his first field goal of this game at the 220 mark of the first half. Texas Tech 11-19 on the season, won only 3 games during the regular season. And they upset West Virginia in the first round of the Big 12 tournament last night here in Kansas City. Iowa State awaits the winner of the semifinal. Great crowd on hand again for this morning session. Another sellout expected tonight. And again, driving on Withy, but not able to finish over that time. But he's not afraid of it.
No way. Nope. And that's how you got to do it. You got to take it right out with him. Maybe you can get him in foul trouble. Certainly don't want to change the way you've been playing all year if you're Jordan Tolbert.
Now the final minute and a half here. Good move by Ellis. Missed that time with the left hand, however. Well, a field goal would be huge here for the Red Raiders.
You know, given that Chris Walker played for Rolly Massimino, if there's no shot clock right here, we'd be in four corners
the same
right now.
Thing, okay? Bring it down to about 5 seconds, yeah. And let's take it in on Ewing to see what we can do. Tolbert, I don't know why you yeah. said it, and yeah. I was just thinking the same thing. Slowly bringing it down to the shot clock.
Yeah.
Now you wonder if we can ever have upsets like that again with the shot clock, right?
Yeah.
You know, both Jim Valvano and Rolly Massimino won without a shot clock and one with it. That time able to finish and get to the free throw line.
And that's about as deep as Withy has got off their set offense, their two-game, their high-low game. Texas Tech has done a nice job for the most part. Take a look. Watch Withy seal up the lane. He's got all that room. They throw that ball. Always say corner of the board. It's a good angle. And first time tonight he's gotten loose on their bread and butter.
Traylor will replace Withy here for the last minute. Relaford Young Withy over on that sideline. Johnson and McLemore are the two starters who are still on the floor for Coach Self. Tolbert steps out. Traylor on him. Gray off the dribble, penetrates, but there was a whistle and a blocking foul.
Pretty good defense by Nadir Tharp.
That's on McLemore. That's a 15 foul. These are also the Red Raiders will take this ball out of bounds. Shot clock is off.
Now we should see a little bit of Rolly Massimino inspired offense.
Kravich is lurking over there against Ellis. Gray keeps the dribble. Kicks back outside. Now they're going to have to move here at 10 seconds.
Very good. I thought Gocho was going to shoot that ball.
Reset it. And the foul. That's on Tharp.
And it's only their sixth. So it saves them free throws.
And it gives them only 3.5 seconds left yep. to work with here. Now they send Hannes in. Now Dusty checks in for the Red Raiders. That's going to bring Withy back off the bench. Shot blocker. Ellis will sit down. They don't want that high lob off that inbound pass,
right? Ryan. Yep. Let's see what they've got drawn up here. Good scouting report defense right there.
Hannes, Rutherford's on him. A runner, and that'll do it. 34-25. The Jayhawks lead it by 9 at the intermission. Kravich and McLemore are two leading scorers here. McLemore started out red hot for Kansas. 5 of 7 from the floor, but Kravich had a couple of good spurts in this game. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly's having a hard time roping a coach, and the coach didn't really want to talk to referees, the players. You
I'm
got him now, Holly.
I'm wrangling you, coach. What was your message you wanted to tell the officials right then?
Well, I mean, they're doing a great job. I just really want to say it's a physical game, and, you know, they're a great team. Kansas is a great team, and we're both bumping and grinding. We just need the benefit of a couple of different things here and there, and we got to play tougher. It's on us, but I'm just trying to help us along a little bit.
The very first time out, you told your team, I want you driving on Kansas. I don't want anything soft in there. How did they respond?
You know, I think they did a good job. Obviously, you know, we got a young team and inexperienced and a couple breakdowns here and there. But for the most part, I'm very happy with my team. It wasn't like it was at Fog Island. They're playing tougher. We just got to really just complete some plays here and there.
All right. Thanks for stopping. Our first interview. I had to wrangle you. I love it.
Thank you.
He's a very likable guy, friend. You know that?
He is, and he's done a good job.
Now, McLemore leading the Jayhawks. And right now, let's send it to Bram and Miles in the studio for our Buffalo Wild Wings halftime report. Take it away, Bram.
You're watching Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods.
Welcome to the Phillips 66 Big 12 Championship, all part of Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Well, the hot zone for the Kansas Jayhawks, Fran, looks like this.
8-for-8 in the paint. Of course, they've done a good job, Red Raiders, on Jeff Withey. Only 2 threes for Kansas by Ben McLemore, the precocious freshman.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit more about McLemore's first half and what you saw and some of the things he could do for you.
Well, very aggressive start, but then the last 7 minutes or so really didn't get into the flow of the offense. But you rubbed the way Bill Self came out early, ran a play for him to get him going. Back screen lob play to the rim. I don't know if I could have dunked this, Brent, but you and I could have scored on that and well executed. Here's a screen by Young, catching one dribble pull-up jump shot. And then here's a good example of get somebody open, which he does. He gets Relaford open. He winds up getting the shot.
You know, one thing, the top two scorers, Josh Gray and Jay Crockett for the Red Raiders, did not score in the first half. That's something to keep an eye on here. Tolbert aggressively goes and draws the foul on Withey. There's Kravitz.
Well, you're right about their top scorers, but you love the way Kravitz and Tolbert have provided some scoring punch. Tolbert with his brute strength, and then Kravitz with a little bit of finesse.
Yeah, Kravitz had 11 first half. Tolbert now has 7. And, Holly, what did Coach Self had to say?
Well, he said, you know, we let Texas Tech get too comfortable. We gave them some confidence in the first half. He's also looking for Jeff Withey to insert himself in this game. He said Jeff didn't really put himself in the game in the first half. Just 5 first half points. Look for him to be more aggressive and more active in the second half.
McLemore popping out, knocking down his third tray.
It's amazing. He's at that point now where when he misses an open look, you're actually surprised. This has a natural shooting stroke, tight, compact. Not much can go wrong.
Over the top. Kravitz, and there was a whistle in underneath on the catch. So Elijah picks up number 2. Jayhawks up by a 10. To Gray, stolen by Elijah. And Gray almost had it back. Relaford to the deck. Hell ball. And it will be Tech basketball. Let's check that. Let me check that. It was Kansas basketball. The arrow was pointing.
No, Josh Gray turned it over, but you got to admire his hustle. He certainly got after it and got back down on the deck, not afraid to get a floor burn there. See, they're not letting Johnson come to the middle of the floor off the dribble. They've done that all night long.
Over the top to Withey. Feeds to Young.
Smart. Because they're double-teaming Withey, Young is being left open at the foul line. Second time tonight, Withey, really good court awareness right there.
So Texas Tech has to be real careful right now. Help defense by the Jayhawks. Kravitz with the influence, the shot. Johnson on the deck. Away from the ball.
Take a look at this, Brent. Now watch Jeff Withey when he catches that ball. You're going to see where Kevin Young is at the foul line. See, now his man's going to come double, and that's going to open it up. For Kevin Young to get an easy two. Sometimes when you back off a guy that you don't think can score, you're actually putting him at an advantage because he winds up getting something he wouldn't have earned otherwise.
Like that time, he had a lane wide open.
Absolutely.
Withey stays with it and scores. Texas Tech's in trouble. for Bill Self has always started with his defense.
Yeah, I think there was a renewed emphasis on that at halftime, don't you think?
Yeah, their double teams have been coming a little bit quicker, a little bit lighter on their feet. Gray gets through as the shot clock expires, did not hit the iron. Jayhawk basketball.
Well, the difference between last night against West Virginia and today is last night, Josh Gray got to the paint anytime he wanted. Tonight, Elijah Johnson and company are making it very difficult for that freshman to get to the lane.
McLemore pulls the trigger again. Oh, that's his fourth three ball of this game. And he now has 20 points.
Tell you, Brent, in December against Colorado, I said there was a chance he could be the number one pick. But Nerlens Noel hurt right now. I like my thought process back then.
Yeah, indeed. He looks like a number one today. Kansas leads Texas Tech 44-27 here in Kansas City. And folks, there's a new sheriff in town. Alex Smith, officially the quarterback with the Kansas City Chiefs, watching our game here today. Of course, he was under contract to the San Francisco 49ers, so he was dealt. And he said he's happy to be here. In a conversation I had with him at the intermission. Very nice young man. I think, Fran, we can all, as the Red Raiders knock down the J, I think we can all feel for Alex Smith and what he had to go through and the way he lost his job. One of those unfortunate things about professional athletics. Yep. I had him when he was a quarterback at Utah in a Fiesta Bowl. Big win when he was coached by Urban Meyer, and I think he'll do great here in Kansas City. With the on a running hook, is going to be on the free throw line. There is Alex.
You know what I like about him is he learned last couple of years from Jim Harbaugh. I thought he was great during the Super Bowl, the way he handled everything with class, and now he gets a chance to play for Andy Reid, another quarterback guru.
No, it's nice to see him drop by and watch a little Big 12 basketball here.
Now, his former high school teammate signed with the Detroit Lions, right? Reggie Bush. And weren't they high school teammates in San Diego?
They were down in San Diego. Yeah. That's right. And Reggie just signed his contract, moved away from Miami, where he had a good year last year, actually.
He's going to be with Calvin Johnson and Matthew Stafford.
They need a running back. Oh, it's been a busy week in the National Football League, though, Fran. Wes Welker, we mentioned him, former Red Raider at Texas Tech, now with the Denver Broncos. There's Crockett looking to get on the scoring column. And I think the Jayhawks now have pretty much seized control of this game. Young finishes.
Now, what they've done, too, is they've cut the heart out of this young team who was battling so so well in that first half. Now the question is, where do you get your scoring from and make up this deficit, if you can?
Gravich puts it on the deck and foul is called. Withy. So we're going to take a break here. 48-29 Jayhawks. Welcome back to Kansas City, where the top seed of the Big 12 tournament, Kansas, is taking control of this game, 48-29. It's our pleasure now to welcome the Big 12 commissioner, Bob Boolsby. He, of course, came to the conference from Stanford, where he did a great job as athletic director out there. Commissioner, you have to be so pleased with the crowd we had for the early session here today, and it's just going to continue all weekend.
Absolutely. Had great crowds last evening, too. We had almost 10,000 in-house last night, and of course, the elephant in the room is how are we going to do without Missouri in the league? And answer is Kansas City supports basketball.
Well, you know, at halftime, I was talking to some fans, and wouldn't you know it, there were a couple of Missouri fans in the audience. They say, we miss coming here for the tournament.
Hey, Bob, you've been a part of that tournament, the basketball committee. How do you evaluate your league this year in terms of not necessarily number of teams, but the quality of play?
Well, you know, I think we've got a lot of good teams, and I think we've got some people probably that won't make the tournament that you wouldn't want to draw in the tournament. And so I think, you know, we're playing a double round robin, and that determines the best champion. We clearly have some people that look like they could be on the top line and may not be now. Depends a little bit on how the next couple of days go. But, you know, I think our league is very much similar to the national landscape. I think there's 15 or 20 teams that could have a legitimate shot at making it to the Final Four.
McLemore missing on that shot. Had to get it right back. Relaford. And here comes with a free throw. There's a foul. Is that intentional down there?
I think so. Yep. Todd Dixon didn't feel like that defender that played the ball. He should have.
Exactly. Bob, I have to ask you, Fran, take us through this replay first.
Well, take a look now. The whole idea here now is, are you playing the ball? And you can see the little shove in the back by the freshman. Easy call for the officials to make. And it's an error of commission by Josh Gray. Wasn't trying to hurt Travis Relaford, just keep him from making that layup.
Bob, you mentioned the double round robin, and of course that's the beauty of a 10-team conference, but fans are always wondering, writers are speculating, and broadcasters too. Is there any talk or thought about the conference growing and going back to 12 teams?
Well, we talk about it all the time, and of course one of the ironies in college athletics is that the Big Ten has 14 and the Big 12 has 10. We're math challenged, obviously, but you know, we like the 10 we have. We're having good top to bottom competition in football and in men's and women's basketball. We like that aspect of it. We're distributing the largest amount of money per institution of anybody in college athletics, and we decided that we needed to establish a high bar for new members, and we've stuck to that. We haven't found anybody that we thought raised the bar in a significant way, and you know, we're certainly not oblivious to what's going on around us, but we like the beauty of the double round robin in basketball. I think it's the truest form of a conference champion, and I think similarly a 9-game schedule in football is the right way. And so we feel pretty good about where we are right now, but we're also mindful of a changing national landscape.
Dusty Hannah's coming to the free throw line here, Frank.
With that in mind, Bob, how have you assimilated both TCU and West Virginia into the league, really in all sports?
Well, you know, they've had a little bit of a tough year. It's West Virginia obviously started out like a house of fire in football, and then found that it's a little tougher playing week in and week out with the Big 12 type teams than it was in the Big East. Similarly, I think both TCU and West Virginia struggled during the basketball season from time to time, but I have no doubt that they will rise to the occasion. They both have veteran coaches, and in the case of men's basketball, they'll recruit well. They've got great campuses to recruit to, and you know, I think that's the beauty of our league. We have great competition top to bottom, and West Virginia and TCU are two terrific additions.
McLemore was fouled on that play, so he'll come to the free throw line. How about keeping the basketball tournament in Kansas City? I know the women went down to Dallas this year and completed their tournament earlier in the week. Will you keep it here in Kansas City, Commissioner, or are you going to move it around? What's your thought there?
Well, we're committed through 2016, and we love Kansas City, and you look around here and see the crowds and see the enthusiasm both inside the arena and outside. It's hard to imagine having a better environment. You know, you think of the great conference tournaments, the Big East at Madison Square Garden, the ACC in Greensboro. Those things are traditional for us, and Kansas City is a big part of our history, so we expect to be here for the foreseeable future. As to whether or not we bring the women's tournament back in with the men's tournament, that remains to be seen. We'll be in Oklahoma City next year, and we haven't been back there for a basketball event since the Thunder's been in town, so we're going to have to evaluate that. But we've led in women's basketball attendance for 13 years in a row. This year, obviously, we have the marquee player in the United States in Brittany Griner. And so if anybody can run a standalone tournament for the women, I think the Big 12 can do it. But we're going to have to evaluate, and I don't see any place else in our future other than Kansas City for the men's side of it. And then we'll have to decide if the women come back here or if we continue to have them separated.
And then, of course, the conference will host that regional coming up down in Arlington, Texas at Cowboy Stadium. That's going to be something with that big screen television. Not a bad seat in that place for a basketball game.
Well, it's you know, it's kind of the best of both worlds. You get to see a television quality basketball game, and you get to be there and have hot dogs and popcorn. But it's a venture that we're excited about because it leads to the Final Four the next year. And so the regional is going to be a shakedown cruise for us, and it's going to be an opportunity to demonstrate that we're going to be ready for the next big show the next year. And so we're excited about it, and obviously we hope we have a team playing in it as well.
After being an athletic director for your foreseeable past, what's it like being the commissioner of the Big 12?
Well, you know, in all frankness, Fran, and you know this having been a coach, I miss the kids. Mm-hmm. I miss the relationships with the coaches. I miss the buzz of campus. I even miss the knucklehead stuff that they do occasionally. But I'm finding lots of great challenges in the conference office, and largely the first 9 months has been an imposed agenda. It's been a big TV contract. It's been the Champions Bowl. It's been the BCS, and it's been all the conference alignment type things. So I'm not real sure what the future holds in store for me, but I've enjoyed it so far.
You have to take pride in what's been accomplished by the Stanford football program that you left behind. I mean, you left it in such good shape.
Well, there are an awful lot of people that had their hands on the oars there, and I appreciate your comment, Brent. We all put a lot of work into it, but Jim Harbaugh obviously did a great job turning it around, and David Shaw is the right guy to take the reins at this point in time, and they put a great strength and conditioning program into place. And you know, it's a narrow population of people who can be recruited to Stanford in football or men's basketball, women's basketball, but among that population, they can really hit for high profile, for high percentage, and so they're gonna do well over the long haul, I think.
Absolutely. As we watch the Jayhawks, what's your feeling about this Kansas basketball team as we approach March Madness?
Well, you know, I happened to be at the Baylor Kansas game last Saturday, and I wondered to myself how Kansas could be down that far, and I also wondered how Baylor could have 13 losses. And you know, they're a team that I mentioned earlier. You wouldn't want to draw them in the tournament because they can put anybody out of the tournament at any time, and they'd certainly look good against Kansas. I happen to think Kansas is a team that can play deep into the tournament. They have not been as consistent as Bill Self's teams typically have been, but they've got terrific talent, and I really think that they've got a chance to play deep in the tournament if they play their best.
How about our two evening games, Commissioner?
Well, you already heard my comment about Baylor. I think Baylor-Oklahoma State will be a terrific basketball game tonight, and Texas has gotten a lot better with the return of Mike Kabongo. They are probably 15% better than they were when he was out of the lineup.
Let's keep him to do the promos.
You know, I just was thinking I'm going to lose my job if Bob keeps this up. That's a pretty good breakdown.
I did it without a note card.
Well, the Jayhawks are in control here with 12 minutes to go, 57-36. And again, if you're just joining us, the winner moves on to play Iowa State. And speaking of that, Fran, if it's round three between Iowa State and Kansas, that could be something tomorrow in that semifinal.
Well, we saw round two, which was a fabulous game. Round one was tremendous as well. And Freddie Hoiberg has done a terrific job. And I think those Cyclone kids would love to get a piece of Kansas again.
Commissioner, I want to thank you a lot for dropping by. We're going to take a break right now. Bob Bullsbury is doing a terrific job of leading the Big 12, and he's enjoying a basketball tournament here in Kansas City. We'll be right back.
Thanks, guys.
Bram, thank you very much. And just as you pointed out, the Falcons could use him. And Turner was nearing the end, a lot of miles on that running back. So there we are, the final in the Big 10 tournament. Illinois at the buzzer, nipping Minnesota, and Michigan. A little revenge in that one over Penn State. And so the quarterfinals, Indiana, Illinois, and Wisconsin, Michigan tomorrow in the Big Ten. And at 6:30, Purdue will be taking on Nebraska as championship week continues here. Meanwhile, the top seed. Now, the issue becomes for Bill Self. And I know coaches always say it's not that important, right? I happen to think being a number one seed is important, if only because the number one's never lost to a number 16. So I like the math.
Exactly.
Okay.
You're a math guy.
Yeah, I am. I see that. And so I'm wondering what chance the Jayhawks have here, Fran, of making it all the way for Bill Self and becoming a number one seed. I think I saw that they're sitting a bracketologist. Joe Lunardi has them a two seed right now. I could be wrong about that, Joe. I apologize.
They look like a two seed to me in terms of struggling the way they did on Saturday. You can't throw all those losses out the window, the three in a row, the loss at TCU. But I honestly don't think Bill Self cares that much. Second and third round games are right here in the sprint.
Yeah, this is the key thing.
This is the key thing.
Get here and play early
next week
in Kansas City. So there you are, and they are in. Joe Lunardi said that Kansas would be the top ranked number two seed. So if any of those teams should stumble, and I tell you, the committee's got an interesting decision to make with Gonzaga. I love Gonzaga. I love the coach. I love what they've accomplished.
Yeah.
Strength of schedule may not be as strong as some of these other teams. I'm not trying to put them down.
Nope.
Love the dog pound. Love the student body out there. They certainly deserve to be number one in the country, but they are going to have an issue with the committee.
Well, let me play devil's advocate on Gonzaga. They're 5-0 against the Big 12. And here's my point. Would they have gone undefeated this year in the league? Absolutely not. But could they have been 15-3? Possibly.
Possibly.
So they would have still been a dominant team, I think, even with Kansas in the league. Even if they didn't finish first in the league. The proof was in the pudding by playing all those Big 12 teams, who've turned out to be pretty good.
Absolutely. Ellis knocking down that jump shot for Kansas, and I think we've got a chance to see Danny Manning's son before this game is over, and maybe even the coach's son. I think Bill Self's going to give a lot of kids a chance here. This lead holds up. He's got some of his regulars about ready to come back in. Wide open look and knocked it down by Andrew White, a freshman from Richmond. We haven't seen much of Andrew.
You know what? His shooting percentages belie what kind of player he is, Brent. I watched him in the fall and the preseason. Very high on this kid. He's an outstanding shooter, although he hadn't shot well in games.
And one. Coming up is Tolbert to the free throw line. There you see the regulars are going to check in. I think this is going to be their final stretch, and we'll see what Coach Self decides here. He's up by 22 in this game at the 9:54 mark, but the starters are going to stay out there for a stretch.
And what he's doing is he's leaving Andrew White, the least experienced player, on the floor with those veterans so he gets a little bit more experience. We're going to be back in Allen Fieldhouse a year from now. We're going to be talking about Andrew White III, young man out of Richmond. Really good shooter.
And you say he's recruited a good class coming in.
Very good.
As usual.
Absolutely. Top three class. They're still involved with two of the best players in the country. He's got big Landon Lucas at the end of that bench from Portland, redshirting, 6'10", about 250.
And he's going to have to replace with him.
Yes, he will. You know, he's done it before here.
Absolutely. Yeah, he does reload pretty well. Young in the lane is hit in the face inadvertently, and he was fouled by Robinson.
And they got a young man from Wichita, Connor Frankamp, coming in, who's a lot like Keaton Page and Phil Forte and Tyro Reed.
Catch and shoot. Tolbert. Jayhawk ball.
What you want to do if you're Kansas is, yep, you want to get the freshman involved, but just run your offense and don't be sloppy.
White again. Designated shooter. Knocked down another three.
I saw him hit 7 threes in a row back in October. Bill Self looked over at me and just kind of winked. Waiting his turn. Gotta be a good feeling for a young man. We haven't talked about Andrew White III all year, right? Here he is at a conference tournament, knocking down threes in front of this crowd.
Tolbert tracks it down. Red Raider ball. Well, 1983. Late Jim Valvano led North Carolina State through that nine-game run, culminating in a national championship. They beat the Houston Cougars. Survive in advance Sunday at 9 on ESPN. Presented by Buick. That'll be the latest of that 30-on-30 series.
That was a year they were lucky to get into the tournament, right?
Absolutely.
And almost got beat by Pepperdine.
Gray with a good defensive play there. The youngster from Lake Charles, Louisiana. Puts it on the deck, penetrates, gets in, and he comes to the free throw line here. The 8-12 mark.
And that's one of the rare times he's gotten to the paint today after shredding that Mountaineer defense last night.
You know, when you think about the most disappointing teams in the league, I'd really put West Virginia at the top. When you look back at the preseason prognostication, nobody thought they were going to come in here and win this league, but a lot of folks had them in the top five.
Yep, they did, and Bob Huggins was fairly confident of his team, too, as I recall back at media day. It's one of those years, Brent. You know, it also underscores if you don't have guys that can make shots, you can look like you don't know what you're doing. And they did not make shots all year.
That's Gray's first point of this game, by the way, one of the leading scorers. So they've just done a great job defensively here for the Jayhawks. And up by 23 at the 8-11 mark now. Elijah Johnson of Las Vegas penetrates 67-42.
And thinking back to that Iowa State game, Elijah Johnson, how about this? 20 points in the last 5.5 minutes of that game. That's pretty good performance, wasn't it?
Fabulous. Kansas did not win this tournament last year. They were eliminated in the semifinal by Baylor. And there's Crockett muscling in. Jay Crockett from Clovis, New Mexico.
The second all-time leading scorer at that high school. The first all-time leading scorer sitting on that Texas Tech bench, Bubba Jennings.
Bubba Jennings.
Yep.
Not this time with the three, and Gray will put it down. Three defenders back, and Johnson picks him clean. Ellis is fouled by Crockett. We're going to take a break here at the 7-10 mark. 67-44 Jayhawks.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Phillips 66, experts in gas since 1927, and in part by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's.
Graham Whiteside in the studio with this All-State March Mayhem update. Cuse up 13 and a half. Didn't stick. Pitt down three. 20 seconds to go. Got the ball when James Robinson gives this gift to Michael Carter-Williams. Seals the Syracuse win. So they're going to face Georgetown one more time. Big East semis tomorrow on ESPN. Out west, Arizona State on the bubble. Boy, they need this one against the conference champ. UCLA led by 8 at the half. Clinging to a 2-point lead now. Back to Kansas City.
Yeah, you're right, Graham. Arizona State certainly needs that win out west. Anyway, here at 67-44, Jayhawks have been cruising in the second half over Texas Tech. And let's go back now and talk about Coach Chris Walker. And Holly Rowe, what's his future look like as a chance to stay on next year as head coach?
Well, I spoke with the athletic director, Kirby Hocutt, and he said, you know, he has been everything we could have hoped for and more. He's done an unbelievable job. However, we have to get this right this time, maybe referring to things didn't go like they would have planned with Coach Gillespie. He said we have a select few that we are including that we want to talk to. Of course, Chris Walker is among those, but it sounds like they will go through a lengthy, not lengthy, but detailed process to make sure they get it right this time. He said we feel like it's a great job, great facility, and we need the right fit.
Crockett on the turnaround. Fran, your thoughts?
Well, I thought the best resume that Chris Walker could put together this year is the way he handled his team, and they came in every game essentially prepared. They played hard. The attitude was good, and I do think, as we watch Perry Ellis continue to improve, that the athletic director needs to try to find the best guy. If it happens to be Chris Walker, then go for it and give him all the resources to be good.
Does Lubbock have to go in and recruit the Dallas area hard, Fran, would you say?
Well, yeah, they have. In Texas right now, high school basketball is as good as anywhere. Chris Walker's got good connections there. It's a hard job, Brent, in the sense that there's not a lot of talent in the West Texas region, but it can be done there. It's been done at Kansas State. It's been done at Oklahoma State. And Chris Walker's done a really good job of bringing some energy to this program.
Yeah, Coach and I took him to a couple of regions.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Andre Emmett, James Dickey had the number three team in the country.
I think Emmett's still got some scoring records in this tournament. I think he's one of the best.
Trailer. Second all-time leading scorer in the conference overall. You can't ask for any more than what Chris Walker did. They were undermanned. They need more talent. But I thought the effort that he and his staff gave to this team was very, very good.
Well, these youngsters have played hard.
They have.
They're coming off of a win over West Virginia last night.
Yep.
So a bit of a quick turnaround to the next afternoon. And I'm impressed with how they played for Coach here today. And it's Crockett coming down. Nice move down the baseline, and Hannah's found him, and they're still working. That's six for Crockett now.
And he's already working on his third coach at Texas Tech. Sure, he'd like them to get it right as well with one more year left.
Ellis kicks it back to McLemore. McLemore a wrap around. Big timer. That's 24 for Mr. McLemore here.
You know how quiet he's gotten, 24?
Well, it's a sign of a great play. Tolbert, good strong turnaround. Tharp is going to be checking back in. Johnson left hand. Texas Tech basketball. Watch this move again.
Yeah, this is terrific, Brent. I'm going to throw you a number right here. Take a look at this move. Acrobatic. In the three games that Ben McLemore has scored 30 points or more as a Kansas Jayhawk, so it's an average of 33 points, he's averaged 13 shots.
Wow. Think about that.
Yeah.
13. That's amazing. Reagan. Mount Tharp, he's picked up, Crockett deep off iron into Tharp's hands.
Only guys like Self and Manning need to start warming up over there.
Taylor was cruising in, scored. Here come to the free throw line. And I think Wesley is up.
Yep.
And I think Coach is starting to move in that direction.
Leo Adams, Justin Wesley, whose brother is a pretty good player at Kansas, Keith Langford, huh?
Yeah.
Remember him? He's making a ton of money in Europe.
And hey, Leo Adams.
And by the way, if you don't mind me saying this, a good friend of ours in basketball passed away this morning, Jack Cohen.
Oh, yeah,
the great coach at Archbishop Molloy in New York City, coached Kenny Smith, Kenny Anderson. Remember Kevin Joyce, great player of South Carolina. And Coach Curran, a good friend to all of us in the New York basketball community. In fact, Norm Roberts played for Coach Curran and worked for him at Molloy. And I know he's going to be sorely missed.
No question about that. Coach Roberts, of course, over on Bill Self's bench.
Yep. Worked for him as an assistant. There you see Norm.
Norm right there. Well, he was a very nice basketball player.
Very, very much
always enjoyed when I was around listening to him.
Coached into his 80s.
Now you'll think about the NCAA tournament ahead of us, and of course, Kansas has been such a big part of it. Winning it a few years ago, getting to the championship game last year under Bill Self. It's just one of the blue bloods of college basketball before Bill Roy Williams did an outstanding job. And for Adams, bounces in. And you take a look at this All-State Tournament Challenge resume. Fourth most of all-time appearances. And they've won 69% of the time, and 14 times they've made it to the Final Four.
Now when you were covering Clyde Lavellette, what was your impression of him as a scorer?
I love that hook shot rolling through there. Before there was a skyhook, there was Clyde Lavellette. I actually got to know him pretty well.
Uh-huh.
Nice man.
Of course, you saw you were actively involved in that Danny and the Miracles action.
Kravitz scores again. They're now by 29 as we approach the last 3 minutes here, and Adams fires on target. Good looking shot.
Another one of those freshmen that hadn't seen a lot of daylight in conference play.
Three misses at the other end. Loose ball. Picked up on the move. And they get it back now. Robinson's alley-oop. And Wesley from behind fouled him. So earlier today, Iowa State with a splendid second half comeback. And they'll be taking on McLemore in Kansas, round three. A couple of great games between those two in the regular season.
Graham Whiteside of the studio, quarterfinals Pac-12 tournament, Arizona State. They've given UCLA fits all year, but many think they need to do more than that to get into the tournament. Blew an 8-point halftime lead. Larry Drew, 8-for-10 from the field. He has 20. 2-point game, a minute and a half to go. Brent.
Wow. All right, Bram, keep us up to date on that. The Jayhawks are closing in on a semifinal game against Iowa State. Kravitz on the line has scored 17 today for the Red Raiders. And you see that Purdue, Nebraska, and the Big Ten will be coming up. That's 6:30 here on ESPN2. Championship week continues. Well, yeah. For the Hoop Junkies, it starts this weekend. And then it goes for the next three.
This is the best.
It doesn't end.
Championship week, unbelievable. That Big Ten tournament is loaded with NCAA tournament teams.
And we've got a handful here, too, my friends.
Yes, we do. Two good games tonight.
I think for sure that this conference will get five, and Adams knocks down a three ball. Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
We don't know about Baylor. We'll have to wait and see about them. Well, but they could play with a lot of teams, a pretty good basketball team.
Let me tell you.
They looked good last week.
They beat Oklahoma State tonight, which they've done once during the year, lost in overtime in the other game. They're going to be talked about.
Oh, Hannah's catch and shoot. Good looking shooter. He's going to be the two guard Texas Tech next year.
Yep.
Going to write that down right now, huh?
Got to get a little stronger, but
it's a very young team when you look at the roster for the Red Raiders. Like Josh Gray, also freshman, is a freshman, so you know it's a young backcourt. They use a little more size. Kravitz has one more year. You know, he can help him. He's kind of a power forward. They'll find another pivot man. And one, Rio Adams. Scores, fouled by Gotcher.
Rio Adams at a Seattle, Washington, Rainier Beach, which plays pretty good basketball out there. I think that, that Jamal Crawford guy that's a pretty good score in the NBA. It's a good high school basketball program.
Now, there's a story that just checked in. Lambert checking in for Texas Tech. Sort of an interesting, that's Clark Lambert from San Antonio. And he has a brother who plays for the Longhorns, and that's Connor Lambert. So we've got brothers, and there's Pops. That's Mr. Lambert there in the stands.
Does the burnt orange come on tonight?
There's the mom. Yep. She's wearing that colorful scarf there. So Clark Lambert's mom, and Connor's been starting for the
He's a nice player
for the Horns.
Yeah. Rick Barnes compares him to Austin Crozier, who he coached at Providence. Had some good games down the stretch of that Longhorn season.
You know, we've got Christian Garrett out on the field. There's Coach Self's son. A three ball is knocked down. Rio Adams, we've got Coach Roberts' son, Nico Roberts. He got some play, and he's still on the floor. And so there's a foul. So we got a lot of good youngsters. Rio Adams, of course, number two. There's Coach's son. There's Nico.
Nico played his high school basketball on Long Island when his dad was the coach at St. John's.
Tyler Self is number 11 out on the floor. Now, Tyler Self had a big appearance. He scored, watch this, runs it in. First 2 points of his Big 12 conference play. Fox says, up by. Got it against Texas.
Well, best thing about that is being able to be around your son every day of the basketball season.
89-56. Walker still coaching away over there on the other side. There's Lambert, and a tap in, no. Lambert comes back. Fall out of bounds, Red Raider basketball. Final minute and a half, and then Jayhawks and Iowa State can get ready. In case you don't remember, as Fran has told you, the first game in the Allen Fieldhouse went to overtime. And that was won by the Jayhawks, and you and I won a controversial ending to a game up in Ames, Iowa. And I think even the conference apologized to Iowa State about the officiating. So round three coming up tomorrow, folks. It's going to be a good one. Foul is going to be called. Wesley.
Take a look at Luke Adams, a young man that his dad is a very good junior college coach in West Texas. Mark Adams, big spring. He had some big moments last year for Billy Gillespie's team. Made some big shots. Not getting as much playing time this year. He's hearing impaired, Brent. You can see his right ear. He's got on the other side, if you guys can get that.
Chucky has something on his left ear.
Yeah, see, he's hearing impaired. He's a great story. Great energy, great guy, great high school player in big spring. And he really has made some, hadn't played as much this year, but made some big shots last year for Texas Tech.
You know, I know you and I like real close games going right down to the end.
Yep.
But I'm kind of getting a kick out of seeing all these kids for both these schools get out, get a few minutes of play time at this time.
It's a highlight.
Nice turnaround shot by Tapsoba. And he, too, is a freshman. He's from Africa, 6'10". Does he have a future, friend, or is he still very raw?
No, he's raw. He's a great student. Really, he's shooting over 70% from the field. Played a lot early.
Now Self running down some seconds and turned it over. Pops won't be happy with that.
That's take $5 off the allowance.
Absolutely.
Right there.
Are you kidding me? Bill Self does a terrific job. One of the best in the country. No doubt about it. Hannah's with that range. Knocks down the long ball.
Now, he was highly thought of.
He's had 15 points here today.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. Back-to-back TOs, baby. Adams will try to track it down. It'll go out of bounds and back to Kansas.
Well, you're right. We're talking about Ben McLemore and Jeff Withey playing in the NBA, but for a lot of these guys, Brent, it's going to be some of the things they talk about the rest of their lives.
No question. Absolutely no question. We always forget about that in collegiate athletics because we talk about the great guys who go on to play in the NFL or the NBA. That's going to do it. So Texas Tech, after upsetting West Virginia, is eliminated by the Kansas Jayhawks here this afternoon, 91-63. Up next for Bill Self and the Jayhawks, Iowa State. You know, McLemore, he was the leader for Kansas today. 24 points with 8 of 12, Fran, knocked down 4-3.
Once again, 12 shots, Brent. You talk about efficiency. You look in the dictionary under that word, you'll find his picture because that's what he is. Makes every shot count. Very smooth operator, great stroke. Lets the game come to him, sometimes too much, but aggressive early and outstanding over the course of the whole game.
Let's check in with Holly and the Star.
Well, Ben, you got off to a hot start shooting from three. How did you guys keep your energy up and really blow this out in the second half?
My coach told us, you know, we had energy in the first half. And he said, you know, end of the second, first half, you know, we were slacking a little bit. So we just went in there. He just told us, you know, we got to bring energy back into the game. So that's what we did. We just came out being more aggressive and just bring a lot of energy to the game.
This sets up a rematch with Iowa State. You hit a game winner in the first matchup. The second was emotional. What do you expect?
I'm just go out there and play my game. That's all.
No emotions?
No emotions.
All right. Thanks, Ben.
No problem.
Holly, thank you. There's young McLemore. where one of the most famous numbers in basketball, the 23 that Michael Jordan took to the Hall of Fame, and the Jayhawks now move on to play Iowa State. That'll be a 6:30 local start tomorrow. And the evening session will come up here in a couple of hours. Right now, let's check in the studio, and here's Bram and Bruce Pearl. Take it away, Bram.
All right, thank you, Brent. Appreciate that. No emotions on the Kansas side. That's hard to believe, considering the first two matchups between those two. I guess we'll see tomorrow what kind of emotions are on the line. Bruce Pearl, Bram Weinstein, welcome on board. You know, when Kansas is good, boy, they can really be good. And once their starters or the main players went out, they were shooting 65% when the game was a blowout.
That's what it was, Bram, and that's not typical for Kansas basketball. What's typical of Kansas basketball is to play great half-court defense, to defend at the rim with a shot blocker, Jeff Withey. They made it very, very difficult to score in this basketball game, but they score with great efficiency. 22 assists for this Kansas team. Ben McLemore, his fourth straight game with 24 points.
They've had some interesting missteps this year, so we were watching them because they were coming off the regular season finale where they suffered the worst loss that the program had suffered in 7 years. Yep. Earlier the year, they lost to TCU. Bill Self came out and said, that was the worst team we've ever put out there. Fodder, whatever. But he was right. It was a bad misstep for them. Unusual losses for them. Do you see them moving forward here with a little more consistency in play after what happened with Baylor?
Defense and rebounding wins championships, and that's going to allow Kansas to be consistent. If you look at the top teams of the country, Duke's got three seniors. You know, Miami's got a lot of seniors. You've got Indiana, everybody came back. Gonzaga, a lot of kids back. Kansas has got four seniors. I mean, I expect this team to be mature and to make these kinds of runs. Now, in the next matchup against Iowa State, remember the game in Kansas. Remember the game at Iowa State? Two absolute barn burners games that Iowa State should have, could have won. This is the best semifinal matchup of any tournament in the country, Iowa State, Kansas.
They're an interesting mix, too. You mentioned the four seniors, so they're one of the most developed teams that are out there, but the best players are freshmen. So how does Ben McLemore fit into all this to turn them into a championship caliber team?
Well, Ben McLemore, and I know Ben and I know his family because I recruited him, he has got a different kind of a personality. He is quiet, he is unassuming. And he is just blossoming at Kansas. He is growing so much on and off the floor, and he's accepted the role of taking big shots, which is what I think he needs to do. He's no longer a freshman, Bram. He is now a sophomore with how he's playing. He is mature, and once he develops the ability to take the ball to the basket left and draw a little bit more contact, he's going to be a terrific pro.
And then it's not fair for everybody else. 8-for-12 from the field, 24 points. Fantastic game as Kansas moves on to face Iowa State. After the game, Holly Rowe caught up with Kansas coach Bill Self.
Well, coach, you guys didn't get out to maybe the greatest start, but what did your guys do in the second half to really gain some distance?
Well, we were pretty efficient offensively, and the first half, you know, we got off to a good start. It's 15-2, and then we kind of puttered around after that. But our offense was their best offense. I mean, we turned it over for baskets. In the second half, we took better care of the ball, and, you know, we made shots, got the ball in tight, and, of course, Ben got us off to a great start. But it's a good win, but what it sets up is a pretty big game tomorrow. You know, the tournament's great. It's so balanced, but I'm sure Iowa State's looking forward to another crack at us, and we're looking forward to the game also.
Given how that last game ended, Coach, I know there were a lot of bitter feelings back and forth. What are you going to try to say to your guys to keep them in the moment and not get over-emotional?
Well, I don't think we'll do that. I mean, when you say bitter moments, I mean, there was no bitter moments between the two teams. I mean, it was maybe some fans or maybe some people not real happy how the game ended in regulation or whatever. But the bottom line is we have respect for them, and they know that, and I think that they have respect for us. And Fred does a great job with his troops, and it's a hard matchup for us because they can stretch it at all five spots and takes Jeff away from the basket. So we need to get a good night's rest and get organized and hopefully play real well tomorrow.
Thanks, Coach.
Okay.